Hey everyone, welcome to another Mix Tank Live Takeover with me. My name is Mark Abrams, and I'm here every Monday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern, listening to mixes off of Mix Tank on Puremix and trying to give some helpful feedback. If you're unfamiliar and new to the stream, today we are going to be talking off of all of the Mix Tank stuff. Sorry, let me throw that up there. There we go. And before we start, I usually like to give a little bit of upcoming events for all the Puremix Pro members. Mix Tank is open to Puremix Pro members, so if you are a Puremix Pro member, get your mix submitted and we'll try to hit it today and during the stream. Before we start off, I'm just going to tell you guys a couple things about what's coming up. This is the last day to submit your mix for the Joe Ciccarelli Alanis Morissette mixing contest. So if you've been working on a mix, make sure you get it submitted before midnight tonight, and you'll be entered to win those prizes from IK Multimedia, which include the Sunset Sound, Sunset Sound Studio Reverbs, the Fame Studio Reverbs, as well as Joe Ciccarelli's new Vocal Strip plugin, which is insane. So make sure you get your mix submitted. The contest is awesome. You get to download a multi-track from Alanis Morissette for her song Guardian and mix it yourself for a chance to win the prizes. After we finish the mixing contest, going through all the submissions, we're going to be back here next Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern with Joe Ciccarelli, where he's going to tell you why he chose the mixes that he did for the top three. We'll kind of do a little bit of a breakdown, announce the winners, and then we're going to do a huge Q&A session. So if you've ever had questions for Joe, this is your chance to get him in. That Friday, we're going to be wrapping up the Vance Powell Start to Finish series with the Weird Sisters. The band came back in after they thought they were done, recorded an entirely new bridge to the song that you guys have seen unfold throughout the past 20-some episodes of the series. And we are going to put out the entire section in one new release where they record the new section of the song and Vance does a remix on the song as well. So that's next Friday, August 19th. Then, 2 weeks after that, on September 2nd, Andrew Sheps is going to have a new video explaining the different typologies of compression. So if you've ever wondered what are the differences between like a FET compressor, a VCA compressor, a mu compressor, all of that, Andrew goes deep down the rabbit hole explaining how the circuits work, how things like feedback and feed forward compression work, as well as giving examples and playing different sounds for you so you can kind of put those into your sonic palette. So that's about it for right now. We've got a whole lot more coming up in September that's going to be pretty exciting, but we'll wait to announce that. And let's jump in. So the last couple weeks, I've been starting off the stream by dissecting a song and talking a little bit about production stuff or some different sort of methodologies that you can bring to your next mix. And today we are going to be talking about Kanye West's Black Skinhead. And this is one of my favorite hip hop productions, I think, and one of my favorite productions of like the entire 2010. The whole record, it just sounds insane. And there's a lot of backstory on the record about how like it was right up against the deadline. And I know like Rick Rubin was involved in the completion of that record. And there's all kinds of fun info out there about it. But the record stands out to me for a couple reasons. And one of them is the minimalist style of production I think was used on it. And then also just the sonics are absolutely incredible. It's also insanely smashed, which is not something that I really dig most of the time, but I don't see how they could have done it any other way on this record. So I love that. So Black Skinhead specifically, again, it's a really minimalist production in the sense that there aren't a lot of elements going on at any one time. And on some of the songs, there's never more than like 3 to 5. And that's any sounds happening. So in this one, it's heavily drum focused. There's a massive 808, and there's one sort of pad element, which is the hum sample that you hear at the very beginning of the song. Other than that, it's just made of the drums, different drum fills, different drum samples, and then tons of vocal samples. But everything about this is using very specific moments for things to happen without ever getting crowded. And one of my favorite things, I call it like almost like mono point source production in a way, because there's a lot of stuff that happens where it's just a mono element. It happens at one point in the stereo field and it's gone as soon as it came. And the cool thing about that is that anything that happens that's super wide feels more wide because you have these individual little points in the stereo field that little elements are happening at. So as far as the drum goes, the intro drum cymbals, while that pattern's playing, every time there's a crash, it cuts perfectly on time. So going back to what I was talking about before the stream last week, I was talking about how when you're doing like edits and crossfades, sometimes making sure that those are on the grid, either your DAW's grid, or if you're playing with a band that was maybe on their own groove, just making that sure that those edits are happening at musical times, and that can help reinforce the groove of a song. So this is actually a really good example of that. Check out the intro drum pattern, how the crashes happen, how they cut off immediately. It's almost like they're, you know, being sample chopped and all that stuff, but they're pretty awesome and a really good example of that. So those chops happen at around like 22 seconds I have. So the other thing, the drums are compressed and distorted to hell, but they play with it a lot as the song goes on. At 102, it just gets insanely pumpy, and like you can hear the bus limiter just like smashing down, and it's like, I mean, the vocals start pumping because of how hard the drums are hitting. And it's a great example of how sometimes the right thing to do is to break all the rules, because as like our engineer brains might kick in, they might be like, oh no, the limiter is kicking too hard and the song's way too loud, and it, like, oh, we can't do those things, there's distortion happening from the limiter and the compression and all that. But the energy that happens from that feels so freaking good. I think it's like exactly the right move to do at that point. And it you know, if you've watched any of the Vance Powell stuff on the site, he's obviously very in tune with the rules. Vance didn't work on this particular track, but he's a good example of somebody that does this, especially with his work with Jack White too. Just completely breaking all the rules and using that to add energy to the song. Like when that stuff happens, especially at 102, it's so freaking energetic. I dare you to not bob your head on it. It's nuts. The other thing with the drums is a lot of the fills that are happening, they're very, again, like mono point source stuff. So you'll have the main groove of the drums happening that's kind of wide, and then you'll have a tom fill that just happens in the left speaker, and it's super loud. It's louder than everything else that's going on, and it pops out of the speaker, and it feels great. So yeah, I guess like my biggest takeaway from the drums of the song is just like, sometimes you just got to break the rules, and it turns out amazing. As far as the vocals go, there's no real reverb happening on Kanye's vocal. There's a lot of short slap delays that are giving him the width, and it almost has like a slight, like small room verb effect on his rap vocal. But then at times he'll completely pull the slap stuff away. Like at 47, there's the slap completely goes away and it's distorted, dry, right up the center. And the other one that happens a lot in the song is there's like a ah scream. Every time that those happen, they're completely out of phase in the left and right. And if you sum your monitor situation down to mono, they almost completely disappear. So again, completely breaking the rules. Like I comment a lot on mixes on these takeovers about things being kind of spread out too wide. This is a case where they are spread out too wide and they're completely out of phase, but it was 100% intentional and it wraps around your head in this really crazy way. It only happens for a split second, so it doesn't make you seasick. And I don't know, it's pretty cool. Breaking the rules again. At 2:13, there's a mono vocal delay that happens right up the center with a ton of feedback. And it's completely mono again. So one of the cool things about all this point source stuff and these short, you know, choppy samples that are happening, everything is just done with so much intention. And you can tell that a lot of times, even if it sounds like it might not have taken long to make one of those sounds, the level of detail and care that was put into where that sound happens, for how long it happens, making sure that the edits are happening inside of the groove with the music, it's just insane. I can't imagine like how long this track actually took to produce, even though it sounds very minimalistic. The vocal samples at 150-ish to like 210, that's a really good example, again, of the mono point source stuff that's happening. They're spreading around, panning around, but they happen, they don't really move as they're happening. They just kind of happen in the spot, go away. Another one will come and happen in the spot and go away. And the effect of all of this stuff, to me, feels like what we are looking for when we're talking about Atmos mixing, and it's done with stereo. So, you know, if there was like a point where you're like, qualified to leave the stereo world and head into the Atmos world, I would say that whoever it was involved with this track is certainly qualified to graduate. So at 250, there are a ton of breaths happening in Kanye's vocal, and all of that is so rhythmic. It's like the breaths become the rhythmic pulse of the song at 250. So I put the link in the chat to check out the song. If you haven't heard it before, go listen to it. If you have, go listen to it again and sit there with the notepad, because it's one of those tracks that I at least love just studying and saying, like, okay, in verse one, here's all the elements that are happening. This is the cool takeaways from it. This is what, you know, I might bring to my next mix, or like if I'm sitting down to just practice mixing, because we should practice just like we're practicing an instrument, I'll think about, you know, how did they do those slap delays? And then I'll try to recreate that effect and really kind of get it into my toolbox of what's going on. So Black Skinhead, Kanye West, check it out. It's amazing. But today we are here to talk Mix Tank Takeover, and here is Mix Tank. So if you haven't been with us before, how this works is on the left, we have a list of tracks that have been submitted by the Puremix Pro members. And in the center, we have our timeline. And then in the middle column below the timeline, we have a place where right now it says no feedback yet. Whenever another Pro member comments on your track, those comments will be listed there. They're timestamped, just like our product, Mix Up. So Mix Up is another mix review service that is used for delivering mixes to your clients. Your clients can drop a comment and it's timestamped. Super useful, cuts down the revision process. But here you'll see those timestamped comments as well. And then over on the right, we've got a bio section about the user, what level they feel like they're at, and then the track status for the mix that we're listening to. So for example, the one that's pulled up right now, he's classified it as an advanced mix. And then he's got some comments about, some info about the track. A lot of times people will put what they're looking for feedback on. And the whole point of Mix Tank is to think of it as a think tank for your mixes. So submit them, get some feedback from your peers, and hopefully there's some stuff in there that'll either answer questions for you or help you elevate the mix as you keep going with the process. That said, like, everything is subjective, and keep making your decisions that are right for your song. But I'm going to try and listen to some songs today and give some useful feedback. So the way that I'll be selecting tracks, I have a draw a track button in the upper left. When I click on that, I'm going to get some confetti and it'll pull up a song for me. And there we go. All right. So this will be our first song for today. This is from Danielle Bazzani, and track status is the final mix. This is an original song I mix, soon to be released. So let's check it out. Here we go.
Diecimila anni sono un gioco, un frutto dietro l'altro, mi ribasso languida a cammini. Sull'asfalto c'è del vino, vuoi scaldarti oppure preferisci anticipare giusto il tempo di spogliarti? Ora, ora. Rapida ti muovi come un rettile, mi sfiori ipnotizzato col rappeso ad un tuo sguardo che mi scioglie con la leggerezza, la malizia di chi riesce come un'onda a farsi largo. Ora non riesco più a fermarti. Come posso farti preda prima che sia troppo tardi? Lasciati portare alla deriva. Non ti muovere, complice divina. Mordo, mordo, più forte adesso io ti mordo. Tutta la carne che riesco a mettere fra i denti. Mordo, stringo, mi prendi sempre di sorpresa. L'amore ti conosce a tutta un'altra cosa. Quasi non ricordo più il tuo nome, la follia non ha ragione di quest'attimo rubato il mondo. Sono un fiume pronto a scivolare, pallido fino a sparire sul tuo letto ancora caldo. Ora non ti devi più frenare, le tue mani sulla bocca stringi fino a farmi male, sorvoliamo l'estasi di un bacio. Non gridare ancora prima che si prenda fuoco, morto. Forte adesso io ti mordo, tutta la carne che riesco a mettere fra i denti. Morto, stringo, mi prendi sempre di sorpresa. L'amore dicono sia tutta un'altra cosa. Morto, morto. morto, più forte adesso io ti mordo, tutta la carne che riesco a mettere fra i denti mordo, stringo, mi prendi sempre di sorpresa, l'amore dicono, 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 questa vertigine mi spinge sempre più lontano, fino a svanire ed arrivare in sole. Adesso io ti mordo, tutta la carne che riesco a mettere fra i denti, mordo, stringo, ti prendo sempre di sorpresa, l'amore dicono sia tutta un'altra cosa, un'altra cosa, un'altra cosa, un'altra cosa, l'amore dicono sia tutta un'altra cosa.
Awesome, Danielle, thanks for submitting. Very cool vibe on that track. Yeah, it's feeling really good. There's some really interesting tones happening inside of it too. I'll just kind of jump right into some of the stuff that stood out to me. I think, like, as you've got on here, you put it as a final mix. I think this is really, really far along and super close to being done. The first thing that jumped out to me was the compression of the overall track, but more specifically the vocal. That felt like it was a little bit overcompressed, which was causing the tone to be a little unnatural for me. And then also making them pretty S-y, you know, as the compressor is kind of letting things go, the S's are coming up and it's getting a little bit harsh on some of them. But it's also giving the perception that they're much louder than the rest of the track. And one of the things that a lot of us do at the end of a mix is just kind of turn the monitors down to almost like a whisper volume and listen for things that are kind of poking out. So when I did that, the vocal felt, you know, a little bit loud to me. It kind of confirmed what I was feeling about the vocal, but it was more so that the compression was just squashing the vocal so much that it made it feel a little too loud dynamically outside of the balance of it. The percussion also jumped out to me when I was kind of down at lower volumes. There are some really fast transients happening in the percussion stuff, and they felt a little bit kind of ticky once I was down at a lower volume. The kick drum has some really cool stuff going on. One, I love the tone that you did for it and how it's kind of like this big open drum that has a note value to it, and it's not, you know, just like a smack to it. That said, I felt like it could have a little bit more punch, and not necessarily like a beater attack kind of thing, but just a little bit more kind of push on it. And that's, you know, the thing that like jumps to mind with that is, you know, doing a parallel with like a DBX 160 or something of that effect, that's just kind of push up the attack of that. Not necessarily, you know, adding a bunch of top end beater sound to it, just something to get it to punch a little bit harder. One thing to watch out for with the sub information of that kick was the note value so long that sometimes I felt like it was changing the groove of what was happening from the drummer. And the way that I kind of like explain that a lot of the time is, if you've ever been to a concert, we have a music hall here in Columbus, Ohio called the Newport, and it's kind of famous for like having too much sub in the room. The front of house guys really love the sub information. But if you have a sub that's too loud in a PA, you'll hear like this big bloom of low end information that just lasts forever. And yeah, it sounds big, but the length of the sub information ends up extending over what the note value was intended to be. So because it just kind of rings, and that's something I'm hearing from the strum in the very, very bottom of it. It's kind of almost like, I don't know, it's almost got another pulse to it, but the very bottom of it feels like it's extending out a little bit longer and then kind of clashing with the bass a little bit. So I would just watch out for what's happening on the very bottom of it, but still try to keep that tone that you have going because it's super cool. Other than that, yeah, just the overall compression of things felt like it was a little bit squishy and fighting some of the balances that you have from time to time when it pumps. So yeah, just take a look at those, and I think it's coming along really well. I put a comment down here just saying Mark was here with a link to the YouTube video. If you submitted, that's how I'm leaving my comments for you, and then you can go track it down inside of the video. So cool. We got a lot of people over here in the comments, which is awesome. What's up, Plaid Bricks? We got Mix in the Cloud. Good to see you. Olaf, good to see you. Martin, welcome back. Mike, good to see you. People from all over. It's awesome. Cool. All right. Yeah, and guys, like, drop your comments on how you feel about the mixes in the comments as well, because they'll see those in the video. And that's what Mix Tank is all about. It's all about the entire community helping everybody out. So let's draw another track. Okay, this is Never Give Up from On Boat Studio. That's awesome. Cool track, man. Totally dig it. There's the part at 258 is super, super catchy. That was great. Nice work. Okay. I got some thoughts on it. One, I'm going to kind of approach this from the thought of, like, this to me sounds like a band playing together in a room and trying to make that, like, records that, you know, sound like that, classic records. We know that sound like that. We have a sound in our head that's associated with this kind of music, right? So thinking about the records I know that live in this vein, The guitars feel very mid-forward to me, and the shape of them, the tone of them, the sounds that are used in the volume of them and everything tells me that they're the most important thing in the mix. I don't know that I feel that they are the most important thing in the mix of this. If I was mixing it, they wouldn't be my focus point. But the way that it's currently mixed, you're kind of informing the listener, this is what you need to listen to. So that's something I would just kind of consider in your approach to this is anytime that we're doing balances and all of that, the whole purpose of it is to give the ear enough information to know, what am I supposed to be listening to right now at any point in the song? And then the rest of it is, you know, once you have your foundation up, the rest of it's wallpaper, right? So on this track, the guitars feel very mid-forward to me. They're loud. And if I were to imagine this band playing on stage, I would, I've done this quite a few times on these live streams, but this is sort of the way that I picture stuff. Like in a live sounding band like this, I would imagine that the two guitar players are out at the front of the stage and everybody else has to stand about 10 feet behind them, right? So in this song, I would consider maybe making the lead vocal a little bit more present. You guys have done a great job of like crafting the song structure on this, and I feel like the lyric's important. So again, I would just like look at where he's sitting. There's a lot of like interesting kind of, there's different reverbs going on within the track, and it's feeling like it's getting a little bit soupy to me. The style of reverb, how much of it there is, and then the length of the reverb, the actual time of it, doesn't always feel musical to me. It feels like it just kind of lingers on sometimes, where I don't feel like we're trying to create an ambient effect, where you might want to use those like longer reverbs and stuff. And usually the reason that you would go for that is to try to make it feel like it's more glued to the track. That can also be done with delays, you know, like the example at the front of the show with the with Kanye, where it's, you know, it's just vocal delays. Sometimes just even doing like sneaking a mono delay up the middle underneath the vocal. A lot of times I'll do like a 16th note, but I'll bury it because I'm not trying to call attention to the sound of the delayed vocal. I don't necessarily want you to even hear a delay. I'm just trying to put something, you know, kind of behind the vocal that pushes the vocal forward in the mix a little bit. So it's giving a little bit of dimension and a little bit of contrast to say like, hey, here's the back of the mix. Here's where the vocal is. I'm just, yeah, using it to kind of pop the vocal out. So that might be something to look at, and just consider those reverb times, maybe bringing them down a little bit, and also looking at the tones. That sounded like a little bit of like a digital hall thing to me, whereas like a plate might feel pretty cool for this, like a very short plate if you want to go the reverb route. Next thing in considering like it's a live band playing together, the toms on the drum kit were panned out much wider than the rest of the drum kit. So if I were, you know, imagining watching this drummer play, he'd be kind of like going on in the pocket. And then if he wanted to hit his rack tom, he's going like to go get it. And then the floor tom's like somewhere over here or whatever. So I would consider that's not necessarily a bad thing if you're going for like a, you know, a certain effect or whatever. Again, like the Kanye thing, the toms are way out wide like that. But when I'm listening to that, I don't imagine one drummer playing a kit in the middle of the song. So I would just kind of consider where those drums are panned and, you know, decide if that's the right spot for them. Right now they're as wide as the guitars are to me. So, I felt like the drums could use a little more dimension too. They were sitting behind all of the guitars, bass guitar included. That was louder than a lot of the drum stuff. So I would consider like, what's the depth that the drums are at? How are those feeling? How punchy are they? And is there something that you can do to try and accentuate the groove of what the drummer's doing to make the guitars and the bass and everybody feel like they're more glued to him? So at 2 minutes, you have the riff part, the riff kind of breakdown, where you have those like stops in the riff, like the da-na-na-na, da-na-na-na, and there's the rest, right? I'm wondering if you could accentuate the groove of those riffs to make it really like I can't stop breaking my neck headbanging if you do some tighter edits on them. So right now, the bass guitar, for example, feels like even though the bass player is muting the string, the ring of the mute is extending into where the rest would be. And if you did some tasteful editing around that, kind of like what I was talking about with editing for groove, it might accentuate those rests a little bit and help it to like kind of pop a little bit more. Also the snare reverb felt like it was really long. It's like going down a dark cave. And I imagine this more like a, you know, like we're in a tight studio room, or maybe like a bigger studio room, but like still a fairly tight sounding thing, not something where I have a cavernous snare on it. At 258, I thought that section was super catchy. I was kind of missing the Sibyl accents that were going on in the section. It felt like he was trying to emphasize downbeats, but he was getting buried behind other stuff, and those big moments of the groove weren't kind of popping out to it. And then the never giving up things that are happening in that section, they have reverb on them. I don't know if you need it. I think, you know, less is more in that section, again, because of the groove going on. I think if you have a long sustained reverb on those, it's like a very articulate staccato part. And by putting a verb on it, again, we're changing the groove of it. So yeah, just look into some of the things, some of the treatments that you're doing, and then consider like, is this the best representation of the groove that the player is doing at that time? So we're there to enhance what's already given to us, not like, you know, kind of rearrange it or whatever. So yeah, I hope that that's useful. Super cool song, and I hope it helps out. Yeah, great. So let me put my comment on here. So Mark was here, and I hope it helps. Let's draw another track. Let me see how you guys are doing in the chat here. Cool, yeah, Primetime giving some cool comments. We got Drew in the house. Awesome. All right, yeah, good comments in the chat as well. All right, this is Amazing Miracle from Daniel Siebert. Here we go. What's up, Monster Trucks?
Thank you.
Awesome, Daniel. Thanks for submitting. Man, there's some really great playing in this. It's a cool song and lots of great players on it. Yeah, very cool. I'll just point out things that kind of jumped out to me. I think that the spreading on the vocal, so if you have like a micro shift or something, an H910, something of that effect is on the vocal that's giving it some width to it. I'm hearing the effect a lot and not in a overly intentional way, I guess. I'm going to keep going back to the Kanye song, I guess. The Kanye delays are very obvious and supposed to be there and part of the affected sound. This one felt like it was there because you wanted to provide width to the vocal, but like you put in a smidge too much of it and it became the focus of the sound rather than just giving a little size or bloom to the sound. So I would just take a look at that, see if it's a little distracting or not distracting, or if it's doing what you set out to do when you started with it. The low end of the kick drum is poking out to me through the mix throughout the whole thing. And it makes the kick sound a lot bigger than the rest of the drum kit, and especially the snare. It's louder than the snare and taking up a lot more size than that. This is something that this is the whole thing of getting the low end of the mix right. And it can be tricky in tricky rooms. It can be tricky on headphones. It's a hard thing to deal with. But I would consider maybe taking off some of the very bottom of that kick to try and tighten it up and put a little corner on the bottom of it, just to make it a little bit tighter. Take back some of the focus from the sub range of the kick and put it in maybe a little more of the mid range. And I think that that's going to make a lot of room in the track, and also help other things feel bigger because you won't have a big sort of blooming kick drum that's demanding attention like that. I felt like you could really hear it in the guitar solo at 150 as well. At that point, the kick's a little bit more exposed and it feels really bulbous, we'll say. The snare felt like it could punch a little bit more too. And part of that is its relation to the kick drum. And then once in a while, I felt like I would lose the snare drum in the rest of the mix. So maybe take a look at the actual snare sound too and see if there's something that you can pull out of it in the mid-range to give it a little bit more smack and punch. Not looking for like the papery top-end thing, but just see if you can make it speak a little bit better. Lately, I've been on a API 550A kick because that thing, like, you can just find a frequency point, kind of boost it up, and then play around with the frequency points, and then you'll find something that makes the instrument speak a little bit. And that one's been working miracles for me lately. So I would say try something like that. Doesn't have to be an API, whatever. But yeah, just look for frequency points that can help it make it speak a little bit. The toms, I felt like they could be a little bit of bigger events. So whereas the last one, it felt like the toms were like pan super far out. This one, I felt like they were really kind of sort of up the center, really inside of the field a little bit. And it felt like they were more mono than they should be for other stuff that was happening in the track. So I would see if you can make some bigger events out of those tom hits. They don't have to pop out of the track or be, you know, so loud that they don't sound like a part of the kit, but maybe they could just be a little bit wider and let themselves be known when the fills are happening. Verse 2 breakdown around 220. I was wondering what it might sound like if the guitar wasn't doubled there or if it wasn't as effective. And the production kind of came down. So, you know, if we think about our energy graph of the song kind of going along, if we came down a little bit, that'll give us another place to go when we go into the next chorus at 250. The guitar lead in the end that was happening right at the center, I felt like that guy could be a bit more present. It felt like it was an important part of the guitars, but the other guitars were taking up more space. They were louder, but our lead thing was happening in the center and the vocal was dancing around the phrasing that was happening inside of the guitar lead. So the way that it's arranged told me that that guitar lead is more important than it's being represented as now in the mix. So I would consider trying to bring that up, make it more of a moment as well. And then I felt like it was a little overcompressed because the pick attacks were kind of coming out of the speaker at me and then the sound would disappear. That can happen if you know, the attack set too low on a compressor or too slow, and then you have so much compression going on that it's like the attack sneaks through and then the rest of the thing just gets smacked down. So take a look at the compression, maybe loosening that up will allow that guitar to speak and breathe and come out a little bit more of the mix too. But great job. This is a really cool production, Daniel, and I hope that that's useful. So I'm going to put my comment on here. Great playing on this one. Hold on, I have to go get the link. And while I'm doing that, I have to give you guys all the like and subscribe notifications there. Got to do the whole YouTuber thing. Be like, oh, smash the stuff all over the place. Smash all the buttons. But seriously, that does help us keep this going. So please like and subscribe and ring all the bells and do all the other stuff. Okay. Next song. It's Jaw Track. How you guys doing in the chat here? Bulbous. Vocab word of the day. I got one. I hope my mom's watching so she saw my grammar work there. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. Plaid Bricks dug the guitar effects on that one. Nice work. And let's go on. Here we go. Plaid Bricks with the ring the bell. Okay, Riff 94 by Tim Thompson. I think I might have hit this last week. I did. I was here last week, so I'm going to draw another track. That song's killer, though. If you guys are on Mixtank, go check it out. Drawing another track. Sophisticated Lady from AC. This sounds new to me. And this one, played and recorded this one, mixed it and referenced it to some other duo stuff. Would like your ideas on it. All right, here we go. Sophisticated Lady.
They say into your early life romance came, and in this heart of yours burned a flame that flickered one day.
Wow. Yeah, incredible performances, guys. That was fantastic. He played and recorded it. Very cool. I'm going to assume from your profile picture that you're the guitar player. And I've got a couple thoughts on it. But first of all, both of you, amazing performances. Unless you sang it as well. And then, wow. And if you played it and sang it at the same time, wow. So very cool. Love the vocal, love the guitar playing. So Tom Foolery and Sonic Science Lab both had really great comments on this. Tom's amazing. If you've seen him on Mixtank, his comments can always take those to heart. They're really good. So he mentioned like the guitar having a slight dip in the 300 area to make some room for the vocal. And the guitar coming down a little bit. I would echo that and just say that they both sound equally amazing and equally as loud, but somebody's got to take the lead. And I love guitar, but it's going to be the vocal for me. So I agree about Tom's comment about making some room in the low mids. And I would do that not just to bring out the vocal, but I also feel like the vocal is just a hair thin. And I would experiment just in the low mids of the vocal, trying to bring out a little bit of body on it. Not so much that you want to make the lead vocal feel, you know, kind of bloated and husky, but giving a little bit more tone down in the bottom to it to show like the fullness of her voice, because you can hear that it's there. I think it should just be accentuated a little bit more, and you can make some room in the guitar to bring it up. So a little less low mid in the guitar, a little more in the vocal. And then I agree about the guitar coming down just a hair. I only had two other comments. One was that the vocal felt like it was squeaking, like there was a high resonance that was just poking my ear whenever she goes into the higher register of her voice and she gets a little bit more volume. Some of that stuff, before you address that, that might be addressed by adding a little bit more body to the bottom of the vocal and making it feel a little bit more balanced. That said, they were pretty resonant, so you might have to deal with something with them. That brings me to the point of don't deal with a temporary problem with a permanent solution. So don't necessarily grab an EQ band on like a, you know, Pro Q or something like that and take away all of that resonance throughout the whole track. Consider something like maybe automating a band at that point. That's the most unintrusive one that I know of. Just go in, automate the band for that resonant point. It's more work though, but so the other one would be you could set up dynamic EQ. And then of course there is Soothe and Soothe 2, which are amazing for dealing with those things. Sometimes they feel like they can chop up the sound a little bit to me. So I'll sometimes just use them in sections or use them sparingly. But yeah, natural way would just be automate a band of EQ at that point, but do it by drawing it in and just kind of dealing with it. The other one, this is... I would say like the volume and presentation of the vocal versus guitar thing would be the most important thing to me. The second most important above those resonances would be the lip smacks and the mouth noise that's happening in the vocal. I feel like I want her to be close and upfront and to be completely drawn into what she's singing. And I am, and it sounds amazing and it's like relaxing and all these things. And then I hear... Sorry about that, everybody. But it totally takes me out of believing that she's in this space emotionally herself while she's doing this performance, because I hear her like, you know, cleaning her throat or whatever. And all of that stuff can be edited out so easily. So first way, just go in, cut out all of the like swallowing sounds, all the saliva, all of that stuff. And then another way, if you still got problems with lip smacks, Isotope Mouth Declip is incredible. It's on the default setting. You can just apply it across the vocal. It's going to take away all of the lip smack stuff and just take away anything that would distract me or pull me out of the song and the performance. Lip smacks are a big thing for me. They always, somehow, I can be listening to a song that's coming from another room, and if I hear a lip smack somehow, it's going to like totally take me out of whatever place that song's trying to transport me to. So it's a little bit of a pet peeve of mine, but Mouth Declick from Isotope totally cleans it up and makes it awesome. So let's see what else we got going on here. Yeah, so Plaid Brick said, got to cut those in-betweens out. I even cut all the breaths. Aha, that's more preference, though. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, some people don't even like breaths. So, or like the Kanye track, though, they were part of the rhythm section, which was amazing. So, yeah. Let's see, body, that's the word in Spanish, I'm sure. Okay, cool. Good comments. Isomatic says, fancy restaurant vibes. I would agree with that. Totally felt like I was in a fancy restaurant for 2 minutes and 21 seconds. Cool. Yeah, really great comments going in there. And to quote Monster Tracks, smash all the buttons like an 1176, hit the like and subscribe and ring the bell and all that stuff. I'm going to totally use that from now on, Monster. All right, let's draw another track. Here we go. This is Show Me What Love Should Be from Mad Fav. And it looks like the level's pretty low on this. I don't have a way to turn it up. So at the end of it, I'm going to stop playing it and I'll wait a second before I start talking so you guys have a second to turn your speakers down. Here we go.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. From head to toe, you were so beautiful.
So beautiful, God.
And I can't hide it anymore.
You know you got that special something that'll make a grown man lose control. What can I do to have you lying next to me? What can I say to make you mine? Where do I go if you don't ever feel the same? Where do I place my broken heart? Show me what love should be. 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 You know I'll always be there for you. I'll write it out just like a play. You know my mom already loves you. Welcome to the family. I love you too. What can I do to have you lying next to me? What can I say to make you mine?
Awesome, Matt Vev. Matt Vev. I love your name. Okay. Yeah, lots going on in this. Very cool. Cool production. Hopefully I didn't blow anybody's head off with the speakers there. Okay, so Tom left comments on this, as he does, and had some really good ones again. There was some things that you were looking for in the comments. You were having a hard time with the bass and kick relationship and overall tone of the track. You're wondering if the bass is strong enough for the track. How is the overall tone of the sound, the song? Are there any crazy frequencies that stick out? So the first thing I would say is like the vocal tone and the bass. I love kind of the minimalist thing that's happening. The downbeat of the kick doesn't come. I think it's 147-ish that it actually came in, which is pretty neat. But the bass is carrying all the low end duties up to that point. And even beyond that, you just kind of decided that that's what that bass was going to do for the track. There's some things about that bass that make it feel a little bit loud to me, but I understand how it could get there because it's got to fill up all that range on the bottom. So I would maybe just look a little bit more at the bottom of the mix overall. There's also some tones in the vocal that might be causing you to want to push that vocal up a little bit, maybe. It felt a little bit boxy and possibly loud, but I think it was because of the tonal shape of the vocal. So to me, it feels like it's a little bit aggressive in the mid-range, like 1 to 3K, like what Tom was saying there. I totally agree with that. And Tom was saying you could put some air on top of it. That might be cool too, a little sprinkled to taste, but I would say, like, work on the tone of the vocal. See if there's some body of the vocal, again, that you could kind of bring up to just make it feel more natural with it. That being said, at 110, I felt like the vocal got a little bit woofy from possibly, like, proximity effects. So at that point, that might be another case for automating some EQ and just making sure that section feels good compared to the rest of the song. But overall, I feel like it could possibly have a little bit more of a natural tone. At 147, when the downbeat does come in from the kick, I felt like it could have been stronger. It just kind of like snuck in, but it wasn't very powerful. And I did feel like it got more powerful as the song went on. So I'm not sure if some changes were happening there. Other than that, the guitars at 220, I felt like the main melody was happening in the guitar, but it was a little bit recessed. There was the filtered vocal on top of it, which is cool, but I can't really hear what's going on in the filtered vocal. And then that lead guitar line was also a little bit recessed, so I wasn't totally sure where I was supposed to be pointing my attention to. But the main guitars and the main rhythm and all of the stuff that was happening on the upbeats and everything, like, that was all still really present and loud, so it was hard to kind of latch onto a melody inside of the rhythm. And then, yeah, I thought it sounded like the kick fattened up around 240. So it kind of ended feeling better for me than it did when it came in around 147. But yeah, I hope that's useful. I'm mostly just accentuating what Tom said, because I think that he left some really good comments on there. So I hope it's useful and good luck with it. Do let me know if you submit another one. I'll check it out. Oops, sorry. I don't need my last name. Just Mark was here. There we go. And let's draw another track. Let's see how everybody's doing. Primetime says rum time. Primetime, rum time. Awesome. Isomatic likes the songwriting. Yeah, for sure. Very good songwriting. Awesome. Really good comments in the chat there. Make sure you're reading those as well. All right. Draw a track. Confetti. Hold on. We already heard you and you were amazing. Draw another track. Riff 94, we already heard that guy. Body, this one's fresh. All right, fresh out of the oven. Here we go. This is from Erin F.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh.
That groove. Aaron, that groove. That thing feels great. The performances are awesome, man. I love the vocal. I love the writing on it. That's great. There's a lot of cool stuff in there to work with. Yeah, we'll just go from, I want to talk about the comments real quick, because you said this is a production you did for a great singer, Danny Liu. She is a great singer. And you try to combine the vibe of funk and roll. You did it. And something with hip hop. I try to make changes from advice of the people in this great community. Still feel I need some advice on balancing. And I think if I had a room and monitors with a lot of lows, so I can define what's really going on in the low frequency. Thanks a lot. Cool. So yeah, Aaron, I think like all of the musicality of this production is killer. And that tells me that you might not be hearing things in your monitoring environment that are allowing you to make good decisions about the mix stuff, because most of the stuff I'm hearing sounds like a consistent thing that's done across everything. So in particular, you're talking about difficulty with the low end, and I don't know if you're hearing too much or not enough of it at this point, but it doesn't feel like you trust the low end of your monitors in this, because it feels a little bit thin, but there's like low end that's escaping a little bit too. Overall, like I thought that we were going to be going from like a drum loop into something that would be bigger when I first heard that loop. And it sounded amazing. Like thinking about like an old hip hop drum loop, I was like, that's the sound. But then I expected the production to get bigger. And then once I heard her voice and stuff, her voice feels a little bit thin. So there's just some stuff that's kind of telling me like you might not be hearing things accurately for it, because it feels like it's the same issue across multiple elements in the mix. There are a ton of great comments happening in the chat on it, and you should definitely check them out. Oh man, our love chat bot is back. It's trying to get us dates. It's trying to get all of us dates. It's like, get out of the studio, everybody. Let's go get dates. Hold on. Let me deal with the love bot. So yeah, going on with it though, it felt a little bit, it felt a little thin to me overall. But like all of the tones and everything are probably there in the tracks. There's awesome stuff happening in the BGVs too. Like I love the production on it. There's a point to me where the hat feels like it's artificially spread out. Like it was happening way outside the speaker. Didn't make sense to the pocket of the track for me. It felt like it should be tighter in. The low bass sound that's happening at 1 minute and 40 seconds, I felt like that could come up substantially. And yeah, I have a comment that the vocal felt thin. 219, the bass can be more of a moment. So let's just take a quick listen at 140. I want to see what I'm at here. Here we go. Yeah, that like 808 sound, I feel like that could come up a little bit. Listen to the Kanye tune, that'll get you inspired for the 808 sound. So there's also something that's kind of like smearing and extending the top end of the vocal to me. And it's distracting from the groove of the song and from her performance, because it doesn't feel like she did it that way. So there's something that's happening that feels like it's almost extending the very top end of the end of her words. And it could just be the overall tone of it, but the feel is so important on this, and everything should be accentuating that. So I just take a look at it. The other thing is the verb, again, the verb that's on her voice, it feels really long for the song and like it's fighting against the groove of the track. So I think of reverb times in like their musical notes. They have musical value. They're a part like anything else. It's not just an ambience or like a wash of stuff, although it can certainly be cool for that. In a track like this where the groove's so tight, I'm going to be very cognizant of like, what's the reverb doing to the feel and the groove of this? Is it taking me out of the push-pull feel that is awesome about this drum loop? And in this case, it's like, it's like taking something, playing a whole note and putting it over top of the funky drum loop and making the, I don't know, it's just, it's taking away from the sharp feel of the drum loop and the good groove of it for me. So I would check out the ending times and the decay times on the reverb and stuff. But man, very cool track. I hope this is useful, and keep an eye on the chat on the YouTube video and also on Mixtank, because people are going to have some great comments for this one. It's really cool. So hope that that helps. As far as the monitoring thing goes, I would just kind of maybe, if you want to comment too on if you're struggling with your monitoring environment and you need some advice or anything like that, throw a comment on here. I'll get notified and I'll respond to you. Or you can, and anybody can, reach out to me, mark@puremix.net. I'm always happy to chat there. And I'll give any advice that I can. Cool. Thanks, Aaron. All right, let's draw a track. I Wish You Peace, version 2. Let me make sure I wasn't here already. This is 10 days ago. This looks familiar. Yeah, Ryan Mondock. I remember doing this one last week. So I'm going to draw another track. Ancestors' Voices in These Troubled Times, Studio Jaman. I remember you doing a track not too long ago, Studio, and it was awesome. So this is going to be cool. This is an early mix of an instrumental that might be used for film or TV, likely remixed in Dolby Atmos. Awesome. Let's check it out. Love that delay feel. Man, what a groove. You just, every time that you put a song on here, studio, like, it's awesome, and it's like a journey from start to finish. It's just a ride. It's so fun. So yeah, thanks for submitting this. Very cool. Really cool track, and I hope you get some great placements with it too, because I'm sure that you can. This is really, really neat. I also love the idea of this being mixed in Atmos. It's perfect for that format, so that'll be a lot of fun. Just real quick stuff off the top. Again, like, Tom left some great comments on this, so definitely check out what he said. The first thing is I would agree with a lot of his balance comments. So the cymbals and some of that stuff in the beginning felt very forward, very in my face, and very loud. And I think that those could have a little bit, you know, less of a feature, maybe some taming in the, especially in like that, like 2 to 5K range, just some of that harsh stuff, pulling that back and making it a little smoother. They're kind of doing like a little bit of a wash feel in that moment anyway. So having a lot of articulation might not be as necessary. And then overall for the entire track, I would say the percussion is very on top of everything. And the groove is obviously super important. Percussion, world percussion on this track, extremely important. But right now it feels so loud that it's kind of casting a blanket over all of the other cool moments that you have happening in the track. And it also feels a bit bright and pokey to me. So I would just kind of look at like the textures of all of that, see if they're, if you're boosting a lot of, you know, top or like upper mid range on those things, maybe consider a little bit of a tamer approach to those so you can make some more moments out of some of the other elements that are happening. This is all taste stuff too, right? Like if you love that and you feel like it's like perfect amount of clarity and everything, then you nailed it. So yeah, the bass gets very subby and less defined around 145 for me. Now the sound of bass guitar in dub music like this is very like, we'll use our word from before, very bulbous, right? So there's not a lot of like rhythmic cutting off of notes and all of that stuff. But the note changes are very rhythmic and all that. They just kind of sustain after the note stops a little bit, which is by design for this music too. But it does feel like it's a little bit big, and Tom suggested around 120. Sure, I would just play around with like cleaning up the, see if you can pull a little bit of the low end out to get some more definition to it. Yeah, so I feel like if the percussion comes down, it's going to allow you to make more of an event out of things like the vocal chants. Those chants are amazing, and I feel like they could do a lot more in the production too. You could have a lot of fun with them, bring them up, move them around, just play with the space and just kind of throw them all over the place. Very cool though, and like those in particular are going to be really fun for Atmos, right? Like having some space that happens from those in the back or something would be really cool. The organ at 3:15, I felt like that could be more of an important thing. It's doing kind of an offbeat, like upbeat and thing, and adding a lot to the groove, but it felt very small and very mono to me. Doesn't necessarily have to be stereo, just I would make it more present so that we feel the rhythm of the organ player interacting with those drums and with the percussion and all that. The snare that happens at 4 minutes felt a little bit woolly to me, but it's only for a moment. And sometimes that's, I did a world percussion record one time, and I found that like if I tried to accentuate too much of the attack of some of those drums, it just wasn't a natural sound, and that's what the drum was supposed to sound like. And that might be the case with what I'm calling a snare here. It could be a world percussion instrument that's just not meant to have that kind of sharp, like, you know, punchy sound to it. So it might be totally fine. You would know more as the arranger and the producer of this than I would about what the intention of that drum is. My instinct was like it might be a little bit woolly and maybe cleaning up a little bit of like the 300-400 area on it. But again, like sometimes you can destroy the natural sound of some of the world percussion instruments if you overcook it with that stuff, trying to do what would sonically be great. Somebody who's like a diehard enthusiast of some of those instruments might be like, what'd you do? That's not how it sounds. So something to watch out for. But yeah, it's going to be amazing in Atmos. I think like just work on the balances and get it feeling great in stereo. And then check out Andrew Shep's Atmos video on the site, because his approach is very much like taking stems from a stereo mix and then spreading those out into Atmos, which I feel like you would want to do here because there's so many elements happening and so many things going on that make a great stereo mix and then work from that as you move it into Atmos. I think that that's going to serve you well. So great job. Thanks again for submitting. I love every time you do. It's always a journey. So cool. All right. Let's draw another track. Let's see how the chat's doing. We got Daniel. He just found my comment. Yeah. Nice to see you, Daniel. Thanks for submitting. Awesome. Thanks for being here too. That's great. Primetime digs a song. He's smoking hot with a leaf. And Monster wants to feel a hug with the sound of the mix. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. I dig it. Okay, let's draw another track. I was already here. That song is killer. We could listen to like one or two bars of that groove again. All right, just a reminder that that groove is super awesome. Let's draw a track. Soul Brother. This is from last year, mega hit. Just make sure I wasn't here before. Here we go. I'm just going to talk about this while we're here. There's a resonant peak that's happening in that vocal loop that's a little bit too much for my ear. So I love stuff like this a lot. I especially love that that's kind of mono where it's happening right now. But that resonant peak is making it hurt a little bit, and I would be tempted to turn down my speaker before the downbeat of the drums happens. So I just wanted to comment on that while we're here. The effect's awesome, though, man. It's cool. Let's go. Awesome. Very cool track. I love this. You're in my wheelhouse from the music I came up on. So very cool. This is from the Nixon Lads, he says. First premix of the new single by the Nixon Lads. Very cool single. Yeah, man, dig it. Yeah, again, like Tom had some really great comments on here. The vocals, overall, I'll just kind of like go from the top. I felt like the vocals were sometimes being buried by the guitars. They felt a little bit woolly at times. So look into the like 300 to 500 mid-range area. The bass guitar, I love the tone of it. I feel like it could come up a hair and cut through the mix a little bit more. Might just be a volume thing on it. And it could also be a kick bass relationship thing, because I feel like the low end of the kick is a little large, and doing like a little tiny high pass on it might do the trick just to tighten it up a little bit. But it could just be that it's too loud and you don't even need to high pass it. I would be looking at the subs for note length, just how long are the subs extending, and if it's too much, then maybe you want to control those with a high pass filter. The other thing is like the bass could just be too loud on the kick. So maybe even just using a low shelf and knocking some back, or if you're boosting a lot, maybe trying to get a little more balance. But the low end didn't totally feel out of balance with the beater to me on that one. So it could just be a volume thing of the kick coming down, which would in turn turn the bass guitar up, probably. Other things I had
Sorry,
were...
Could you say that again? Sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you.
Sorry, Siri. Okay, so on the verses, the other things I have are kind of percussion or production things. So I was thinking on the verses, they could probably come in a little bit and come down just to make room for everything to explode when you get to the chorus, because you have these two different sections happening. You have like a very hooky chorus happening. It's very catchy. And then the verses are more of a groove. They're a vibe. They're pushing. They're forward. And I think like anything you can do to make more of a scene change happen from verse to chorus is going to help make it a fun ride for the listener. So yeah, like two ideas I had were like the vocals could, or the guitars could come down and pan in a little bit to make some space for everything to grow when we get to the chorus. I thought it might also be cool if you push those vocals really hard in the verse. Tom suggested parallel vocal compression. I would say that overall is a great idea. But then on the verses, I would also consider like, I mean, really pushing them. Like, what if you have any kind of like preamp plugin, if you just blow the preamp up on any of those plugins, like you'll get a distorted, pushed, inherently compressed sound that might be super cool for that, or just doing some kind of a distortion thing on there. Not like distortion pedal, run it through a guitar amp. That's not totally what I'm hearing. I'm just hearing more like kind of going too far with a decapitator or something like that. That'd be pretty fun, and then that would allow it to open up into the more catchy chorus. If the vocal cleaned up, it would also kind of give the, you know, the feeling of like, here's our open hook or whatever. So just an idea though. Last comment I had was just to watch the tuning on the harmonies, the vocal harmonies around 245. You're a Puremix Pro member because you submitted a mix, so you have Melodyne Essential for free in your account. So that's for everybody. If you're a Puremix Pro member, make sure you click on the badge in the upper right of Puremix, go down to My Plugins, and you'll have a bunch of installers for awesome plugins. One of my favorites in there right now is the Eventide SP 2016. That reverb's insane, and it's free. It's awesome. All right, I hope that helps. Let me put my comment down here. And very good job, Laster. I'm looking forward to hearing that. If you have questions, comment on here. Email me, mark@puremix.net. Or comment on this, and I'll get a notification as well. But yeah, I want to hear the next version of that. So hopefully next week. Let's draw a track. I think we got time for... Hold on. I'm not ready. This is 33 minutes ago. Awesome. All right. I think we got time for two more. So what I'm going to do... Ah, Christianus is here. What's up, Christianus Kernagas? Siri's loving the mixing advice. Yes. Awesome. Martin, thanks so much for joining. Awesome, man. See you next time. Mike, great comments. Not a lot of low mids. It's true. Yep. Great comments in the chat on these as well. Thanks for submitting, guys. Make sure you keep doing that. Looks like our love bot got back in there. No, I got him out. All right, cool. Primetime says SP2016. Guys, here's a reminder. Smash all the buttons, the like buttons, the subscribe buttons on whatever platform you're watching on, Facebook, YouTube, all that stuff, Twitch. Twitch, I'm talking to you. We need more Twitch people over there. Do like the bits or whatever the Twitch thing is that you kids do over there with your twitching. So here we go. Contest for everybody in the chat room. Gus Gomes is in Pittsburgh. What's up, man? I'm over in Columbus, so I'm not far from you. Here's what we're going to do. If you put a song on that I haven't gotten to yet and you're in the chat right now, the first person that says listen to my mix in the chat, put your Puremix Pro member name in there too, and I'm going to listen to your mix before we get out of here. You guys come, a lot of you guys come every week, and I want to make sure that we get to you eventually on here. So, there we go. Ah, Primetime says my V2 is in it. Primetime, if you're talking about the mix that we heard from last week, let me know, and we're going to check it out. If that's the one. All right, here we go. I'm going to listen to this while you guys do that. We're on a YouTube delay. It's a thing. Here we go. This is from Aaron. He says, this is my second try with this song on Mixtank. Looking for more good input before I put it out. Let's go, Aaron.
I know my days are numbered. 26,203. The sand is tumbling. The shadow of the sundial on me.
Cool piano sound. Monster, I'll tell you about that reverb in a second. We'll get there. Awesome. Cool. I want to listen to one more section here. So hold on. Here we go.
The shadow of the sun. 203.
Okay. So this is a good example of too much bus compression on it. Great job overall, Aaron. I hear a lot of cool stuff happening in here, and it's on the way to being something cool. So keep at it. This is cool. So first thing, again, this is a good example of too much bus compression. So Let's listen to the beginning, listen to how loud the vocal is, listen to the depth between her and what I would call the back wall. So if she's right here, what's all the stuff that's happening back here, right? Let's take a listen. Here we go.
The sand's tumbling, the shadow of the sundial on me.
And then let's listen to the biggest section of the song. So I'm going to do it fast. I'm going to play the beginning, then I'm not going to talk, and we're going to listen to the back half here. Here we go.
Sand's tumbling, the shadow of the sundial on.
One more time, specifically her vocal.
The sand's tumbling, the shadow of the sundial.
So the intro is very much the same volume, and obviously there could be volume automation stuff going on here. I'm sure that there is. Otherwise, it would, yeah, probably sound a lot more smashed than it does. But not just the vocal level in the beginning, but I'm also hearing a lot of that lip smack stuff. There's a lot of noise coming up that's happening, and that's from things being pushed down too much and then brought up, right? So it brings up all the kind of the nasty stuff in the noise floor. So I'm hearing a lot of that in the beginning, and then in the louder section at the end, everything feels kind of like choked and tight and buried a little bit, like it's just kind of getting the life sucked out of it a hair. So just look at the overall compression of the track and see if you're smashing it too much. Another indicator of that is the subs of the bass guitar are coming up to me in a way that like almost made me question, is that a sub bass, like a synth, or is it a bass guitar? So that was answered for me in the outro here.
203 days are numbered, all 26,203.
So there's distortion on that bass, which is cool, and like it sounds like there's a good tone in there, but it's very kind of dark and not, it doesn't have a whole lot of texture or tone to me, or you know, like if it's being on fingers, if is that a finger bass? Sounds like pick actually, but there's not a lot of upper end detail to it, right? So usually like 1/6 is pretty awesome for bringing some of that out, like 800, 1/6, somewhere in that range, in that octave is really useful in an EQ to bring up some of the detail and attack and texture of a bass guitar. I feel like it could use a little bit of that, and then the subs feel a little out of control to me. So I'd check out what's going on the low end with it. Might even be able to shave some of it off with a high pass, but maybe you could just bring the bass down too. Overall, the vocal felt bright to me. There's some tuning issues going on with it, especially kind of in the intro where she's by herself. That is the first time that we're introduced to the song, and we want a new listener to stick with us, right? Up until the production gets bigger, and then hopefully by the end of the song they're in love with us. But in the very first intro, if she's singing out of tune and it's grating, then it's not going to keep the listener engaged to continue on through the song. They're either going to hit the next button or move on. So again, Melodyne Essential is in your Puremix account. Somebody asked how they access that in the chat, so I'm going to show you really quick. So if you're on Puremix, you go up to your name in the upper right, and then you go down to your plugins and services, and you got all of this stuff for free. This sounds like an infomercial right now, but I'm just answering a question, I promise. So yeah, there's your plugins that you can get, and you can grab Melodyne Essential. You'll get a coupon, you go over to the site, you download it, it's amazing. And that'll help with the pitch things that are happening in the beginning of this song. So I definitely would say to spend some time on that, Aaron, and make the intro just as good as it can possibly be. The vocal also felt very loud to me throughout the song until we got to that part where I was using it as an example of getting kind of smacked down. So just look at the vocal throughout the song and consider doing some like volume automation rides. It might even be beneficial in this one. This is not to say that everything here is bad, so please understand that. Like, I think it would be useful if you tried bringing all the faders down and rebalance the mix and then put it together, and just even as an alternate, like do a save as and do it for practice, if nothing else. Bring all the faders down, rebuild the balance of it, and see how it feels to you after doing that. If it might make you question a little bit more of like what's important, what should sit on top, and then your balances might feel a little bit tighter. Just an idea, but the guitar on the left, this is more toward the intro of it, felt very separated from the mix to me. And one way that you could try to glue everybody together would be to put them in more of a unified space. So possibly like have multiple elements sharing the same reverb to kind of tell our ears, get some like psychoacoustics going in there, and make us feel like they're in the same space and everybody's kind of glued together. That guitar on the left that happened somewhere toward the beginning of the song felt dry and a little bit loud. I felt like the background vocals could come up a hair. Again, watch out for tuning stuff. Doing the like, you know, again, like that DBX 160 parallel trick or any compressor, just lets the attack through on it, bring it up in parallel. Could help add a little bit more punch to the kick. Another thing is if you deal with the sub that's happening in that bass guitar, that's going to allow the kick to speak a lot more too, because they're probably fighting for a lot of that range now. So if you make some room for the kick, it's probably going to feel more punchy as well. And then just the vocal tone just felt kind of bright, brittle, and overcompressed. So I would just maybe rework some of that. Look at your compression on there. Look at your EQ. Look at the balance of things and see if you get something you like from trying it. But obviously, keep what you got here because there's good stuff going on. And then just as an experiment, see what would happen. Also, I love your profile picture, whatever that is. It reminds me of like a cartoon drawing thing. On the outro, I felt like things dropped out at kind of odd times too. So, but that's production thing. You might just be the mixer on this too. Cool. I hope that helps. And thanks for submitting your song, Aaron. That was great. And we got time for one more in here. So let's check this out. I'll tell you what, we'll do two more, I think. Hold on. The bots are back. If you guys know how to kill the bots and stop that problem, you should let me know. Because the bots suck. You keep trying to get us out of our studios and into dating. This is a mixing place. Nobody here is interested in dating. Or we should be, but yeah, okay. Let's see. Oh yeah, that's right. Primetime points out there's a Puremix interview with myself and Andrew Sheps and Mick Guzowski, and we talk about the SP 2016. That's right. Nice. Thanks, Primetime. Don't be afraid to release low level for tracks, folks. It doesn't matter. Yes, monster tracks. Very good point. If you're doing an export for Mixtank, no need to like smash or anything. And in general, you don't need to smash, but we won't go down the loudness wars rabbit hole right now. So I want to get to some more mixes. So Primetime, as promised, I'm going to check out your new version. I think that's your username, so I can find it. And then, Monster had an idea for the last song to use to do some de-essing. Yes, that would help as well. Okay, and let's see. So also Chris Baltazar in the chat asks for feedback on Reminiscence. So I'm going to hit Primetime and Reminiscence before we get out of here. Awesome. Primetime, thanks so much. See your comments. Okay. Let's see. Let's look for Reminiscence here. So we'll hit this one first. Chris, thanks so much for being in the chat. Thanks for submitting the mix. Let's check it out. Here we go.
You enter my heart for just one second, and it feels like a thousand years just go by. But I didn't get the chance to say goodbye. I see a lifetime in just one moment, and there's just no room to breathe. Every corner filled with minutes that don't belong to me. I can't buy. Control. tries to chase that impossible dream in my mind. Well, there's no goodbyes, but if there's one thing that I can do, it's to change how I remember you. I see a lifetime in just one moment, and there's just no room to breathe. Every corner filled with minutes that don't belong to me. I can't
awesome. Okay, this is from Chris Balthazar in the chat. Thanks so much for submitting, man. That's awesome, and thanks for being here. There's a lot of cool stuff going on in here, and I feel like you've got a lot of good sounds inside of this thing that you can pull from. So, yeah, overall very cool, really good song. I'll just kind of talk about the first things that jumped out to me off the top were... I'd say the first one is that the vocal feels very compressed to me, and this is all taste stuff, but this one, it feels a little overcompressed, and the reason I'm feeling like overcompressed is the right word is because it's causing a little bit of like a low mid bloom thing that's coming up, and you can feel a lot of the attention, like the detail, the little dynamics between words and stuff has all been kind of flattened out, and it feels a little unnatural to me. So, because of that too, I feel like you're getting like a low mid bloom in the reverb, which I feel you can hear, especially at 25 seconds. There's like a little resonance that pokes out in the vocal when the compressor is kind of releasing there that, kind of blooms out in the reverb. So an idea for that would be trying out parallel compression instead of insert compression as the only approach that you have on it. I would still, you know, do an insert compressor on if the vocal wasn't recorded with compression, and if you feel like it really needs it from the raw track, I would, you know, you can still do a little bit of compression, mild compression on the main track. But then I would say try doing some parallel compression on that vocal. One that was pointed out to me that I love is the factory default setting on Devil Lock Deluxe. It makes an amazing vocal parallel compression thing. You can put that on a, you know, if you do a aux send at Unity to another aux return track, you can just tuck that up into the vocal and you can bring up a lot of the stuff that you want to bring up. That compression would, you know, sort of bring the dynamic range in closer without taking away the natural attack of the vocal. So parallel compression is going to help a lot. It doesn't have to be Devil Lock. It can be, you know, any compressor. The goal here is in that one, you're looking for an overcompressed vocal sound that is going to give you the meat and all of the stuff of the signal that you want to kind of bring up inside of the vocal. But you're going to preserve the natural transients if you don't compress the original track too much. With all of the overcompression stuff, brings up the nasty stuff. There's mouth clicks going on. We talked about that a little bit earlier. Isotope, mouth declick, default setting, sounds amazing. Gets rid of all that stuff. 126, check the tuning. The low mid harmony is poking out to me in a balanced way. It was too loud. And then there were some tuning things going on between them. They also felt like they were a bit mono, like you could play around with panning those harmonies out a little bit to make them bigger and a more important part of the mix for the listener. The tracks compression feels like it's a little too harsh as well. I don't know, bus compression, limiter, but it felt like it was making the low end flutter a little bit, flattening out the drums, so I wasn't getting to hear the attack and the stick of the drums. They didn't feel very detailed to me. They felt like they were kind of like a flattened package that was put in there. Yeah, around like 3 o'clock, especially, I felt like I needed more, 3 minutes, sorry. I felt like I needed some more detail from the drums. It kind of had that feeling of like I was outside of the venue listening to the drums come through. Like there was a lot of reverb and not much detail on them. Not that extreme, but like that was the general kind of thing I was thinking to explain it. So yeah, watch out for like over-limiting, all that stuff. And then my suggestion would be too, like if you did a save as of this, maybe tone back some of the compression on the bus and try balancing it in the chorus or in one of the bigger sections of the song, and then building your verses from there might kind of help you out, so you can get the feel that you want from the chorus and then work the other sections in around it. I do that sometimes on mixes that just have a ton of stuff going on in the chorus. I'll work on getting the chorus right, and then I'll make the other sections work right around that. Versus if you start with the verse, sometimes you can have what happened on the last song where the verse and everything feels dialed in, but then you get to the end of the song and things start feeling like they're getting lost. So yeah, I hope that helps, and thanks again for being in here, Chris. Looks like there's some good comments going on. Yeah, good comments happening over in the chat too, and Isomatic, super dope, loved it. Primetimes is a very nice song. It's awesome. Piano chords are a little bit muggy. Isomatic was thinking for bringing some stuff up. There we go. All right. Cool. Thanks again, Chris. So let's find Primetime. We're going to close out with you again today. Thanks so much for showing up again. Okay. 2 hours ago. The new Alanis Morissette Guardian mix from Primetime. I love it. Okay. Yeah, man, you got, according to my clock, maybe 7 hours left to get this in. So let's see what we got. Here we go. Ah, what happened? What happened? It reset. Let's go back. Here we go.
Where was your watch?
That was me. You guys aren't skipping or anything. We'll talk about that. Awesome prime time. I'm going to go back just a hair and listen to another section.
They were distracted and shut down. So why?
Nice work there. I'm hearing like a flaming thing in this verse that I wanted to listen for. It's like a second note happening, almost like a slap delay, but it's from like a room. And I don't remember if the room mics sound like this in this multi-track or not, or if it's something going on inside of your session. But I hear like a flam on the drums through this verse. Especially on the side stick. And that's just kind of muddying up the groove for me. And I can't play this for you guys, but I'm going to listen to the original at that same spot. I just want to see if it's in the release track. We're going to cheat. Hang with me. Okay, cool. So I don't hear it in the original. So, yeah, I think that there's still something to check out there, Primetime, just to see if you're getting like a weird, like if you're in Pro Tools and you exceed delay compensation, sometimes you can have this where like rhythm will sound kind of messed up and things will get flammy. Check into that. Just see if there's something going on inside of it. I don't think it's on my end because I don't hear it in that original one, but let me know if you catch anything, on this one. Mixing the Cloud says a little tickle in the vocal top end. I agree with that. Primetime says his own hi-hats don't sound good. Well, there you go. You got something to work on with them. The other thing, I feel like overall it's lacking a little bit of low end, a little bit of heft in the bottom. As far as like the submitting it for the mixing contest, like the whole point of this is 100% just to like get practice. So the practice thing I would do, because I don't want you to like throw off your entire low end of the mix or anything, but the practice thing I would do would be to compare this to the actual released version. And you might not like the low end that's in that mix. That's okay. But compare it to yours and just see where you're kind of at and compare it to a couple other mixes in this style that you dig and just kind of see ballpark where you're at. You wrote on here, it's version 2, but my real life is version 48. So you are in the very fun rabbit hole of this mix for sure. And I think like normally I would expect a version 48 to sound much worse than this too, because you can just go so far with it that like Yeah, you lose all objectivity and interest and passion for the mix too. So congrats on sticking with it that long. And yeah, I think it's coming really, really well along. If primetime, if you feel like you got to keep going after the mixing contest, like whatever you submit by tonight will be the one for the contest. But if you're learning a lot from this, keep going with it. Prizes be damned. Like the knowledge you can get from just going through this process is worth way more than winning all of those plugins together. Yeah. So let me go to my notes here. So coming out of course one, the part I played a couple times, I think that is here. So the spread out vocals feel like they're leaning a little bit left to me. They get a little bit pokey in the upper mids, but it's not a huge deal. Overall, I think that they're too loud right there. And when we get to verse two and she leads that line off with you, she needs to be like here. She's reclaiming the front of the stage. She's saying, you listen to me. Like she's right there. And you got to make her the star power there. So those background vocals, not sounding like they're fading out, you know, necessarily going into that, but they need to tuck back and, you know, step back on the stage, let Alanis come back to the front, in front of her clones or whatever, and like start singing the song again. So just watch out for the transition there. It's scene changes are huge to me. Like each section of the song needs to feel like a new part and like have new things and all that. Or, you know, if the production calls for that, that is, of course. But this one definitely does. We're stepping out of the big rock chorus, we're going into like a side stick feel. She's coming closer to us. The wide vocals need to step back to the stage and let her reclaim the front. So I think you've come a really long way with this, and it's awesome. Great job on it. I wish you the best of luck in the contest with it, and make sure you get it submitted in there so that it's in. If you end up doing one more pass before you submit it, I'm not recommending that you change anything wild or whatever. If you're feeling really good about this, go with it. Go with your gut. But maybe just check out the low end on the other one, see how it's feeling. For objectivity, it might even help to just listen to Joe's released mix all the way through, then take a breather and then listen to yours. Turn the monitor off when you do this. Like, just listen, you know. But don't listen too hard. Just listen to see how it feels. Just listen, but don't listen too hard, but listen for all the things, but not too hard. And it's all confusing, right? I hope that that's useful and it works out for it. Hold on, the bots are coming after me again. These bots are killing me. I'm hiding you from the channel, love chat. All right, cool. Everybody, thank you so much for tuning in today and for submitting mixes. Mix in the Cloud says my version 7s are often my best. That's awesome. Juan, you asked why I don't draw a track to choose the theme. We were the whole time, and then I threw something in it at 4 o'clock. We went a little bit long today. I wanted to give a shout out to some of the people in the chat, and Irana, like, as fast as you can, put your name in there and I'll hit the song. So, next week we'll be back to drawing a track. I promise it'll be fair. Cool. Guys, thank you so much. Primetime's in Logic. Awesome. Logic's awesome. I'll see you next week, 2:30 p.m. If you're participating in the Alanis Morissette Joe Ciccarelli mixing contest sponsored by IK Multimedia, make sure you submit your mix before midnight tonight. Do it by 10 o'clock your time, just to be sure. Do it now. Do all the things. And while you're doing all the things, make sure you hit like and subscribe at the bottom. Ring the bell. It helps us to keep this going. We would love to keep, you know, showing up here every week. It all depends on how well the show does on YouTube and all that stuff. So please help us out. And we'll keep it going. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Primetime. Thank you, Alexander. Thank you, Mix in the Cloud. Thank you, Juan. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Isomatic. Thank you, Plaid Bricks. Thank you, Christianis. Thanks, everybody. See you next time. Just kidding. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Kevin. All right. Bye. I see you, Iroh. Thank you.